So, yeah, thank you and welcome to my talk, where I'm going to present new benchmarking results on protein ligand binding free energies with the Parsley parameters. I'm starting with a quite busy slide, if it pops up. Yeah, here showing the increasing interest in binding free energy calculation for drug design purposes by different companies. You all know the names, Merck, Roche, Bayer, and Boehringer Ingelheim. And there's also an increasing number of publications over the years. And that's why we are looking into calculating binding free energies. I'm in a perfect position for this as a postdoc being employed by Janssen, but working for the open force field. And my goals are to evaluate the new open force field parameters in retrospective drug design projects and to generate an open protein ligand benchmark data set. Benchmarking is part of the open FF infrastructure. So what we do here, what I do here is to create a data set which will provide input structures for a benchmarking and analysis of the results, where I use the open force field parameters. And finally, yeah, these results are compared to the free energies deposited in the benchmark set, and also finally want to validate the parameters and maybe give feedback at some point about shortcomings and successes of these open force field parameters. All my work is public, so the benchmark set, then the PMX workflow where I'm working with people from MPI Göttingen on, and the free energy framework, which should allow to make consistent analysis of free energy calculations, which should be then comparable over different methods and parameter sets. This is together with Hannah Bruce McDonald from the Codera lab. By testing the parameter, we have to be aware that testing only the parameters is quite difficult because there are challenges in every part of the workflow. And next to the parameters, we can have errors in the input or flaws in the input quality. Then we need to set up the simulations correctly and finally sample long enough. And then also the presentation interpretation need to be consistent and correct. For the benchmark set, we have specific requirements. It should be a benchmark set which is used by the whole community, and it should enable really to compare and measure the improvements in methods and parameters. Therefore, we need a publicly accessible data set. It should be sustainable, that it is still available in 10 years, for example, and not somewhere hidden or going to be deleted on a private repository. Then we want to have consistent high quality data, which is clean, interesting to use, and of course documented, and also demonstrations and examples should be available. Here, that's where I am right now. We have a publicly accessible benchmark data set, which should be sustainable because it's part of the open FF infrastructure, which should last longer than my postdoc. I'm trying to include consistent and high quality data. For example, I only store primary data and conversions are done on the fly. I'm working on an easy usable interface to retrieve and analyze the data. And finally, there are also examples and demonstrations on Jupyter Notebooks. Currently, we are here at stage one, so we including published calculations, starting with a Schrödinger checks dataset and extension by a couple of targets from Janssen. The input data is altered as little as possible to make it possible to compare the results to the previously done calculations. On a later stage, we want to refine and categorize the data, meaning to improve the input structures when necessary and to categorize, for example, by quality or the challenging aspects of the different data set. And as a last stage in long term, we want to include meaningful new data sets, for example, new targets or target classes, new chemical space or specific objectives, challenges which one has with with a specific data set. As an example, for the easy to use part, I have here a Jupyter notebook, which shows how easy you can retrieve the specific perturbations for one target, in this case thrombin, and you get the data frame which you can visualize and which you can filter with a Jupyter notebook. Now, I use this data set to rerun free energy calculations with a new open force field parameters, the parsley 1.0.0. I have run calculations on 14 targets with about 300 ligands in total and 500 perturbations or transformations. This is approximately 1,000 days of calculations on one GPU. I use the Janssen AWS server. The first result revealed that we agree with experiment quite well in many cases. So with an RMSE lower than one, sometimes it's a bit higher, and also quite nice correlations. The gray targets here, there are some edges not run yet. That's why it's not complete data yet. we can also look at other metrics to assess the performance, especially in view of drug design. We are usually not interested in the actual absolute delta G values, but the order of the values, so prioritization of best binding compounds for synthesis. And I made this small experiment. If we take the five best ligands based on the calculation, how many of them are within the five best on the experimental results? And we see here that in many cases, we have at least three targets hits, so to say, within which are also the best experimental results. Now let's look a bit more into detail. Here I'm showing the distribution of deviations from the experimental data for the perturbations, not the binding free energies anymore, but the actual perturbations or simulations run. And also here we have quite encouraging results. More than a majority of perturbations have a deviation from experiment less than 1 kcal per mole, and the standard deviation is around 1.4 kcal per mole. It's also interesting to see that most of the outliers are in few targets, CMET, MCL1, and PTP1B, which could hint to unsuitable setup or just difficult molecules which are not well parameterized. One problem is, as I said before, it's not only the accuracy of the parameters, we also have sampling issues sometimes. So I wanted to see whether we can filter out the non-converged simulations. And I'm using a convergence metric here to filter out filter the total data set into converged and or divide the data set into converged and non-converged simulations. And you see that you can get a slight improvement in the standard deviation for the converged and much wider distribution for the not converged simulations. But you also see in the non-converged simulations, you have perturbations which agree quite well with experiment. That's probably the method which is also gives reliable or good results if you don't have a complete sampling of the phase space. And I also tried other metrics to evaluate the convergence and which gave similar results. So let's look at the outliers. 10 out of the top 10 outliers, 8 are from the CMET set. And again, a hint for uncertainty initial structures. The top outlier here is this perturbation, which on the first view doesn't look too complicated. It's just a perturbation from a sulfur to a nitrogen or and the creation of a hydrogen here. So we got a deviation of about 8 kcal per mole from experiment. It's interesting to note that we also have a deviation in the results done or in the calculations done with GAF parameters. I looked at the input structure, and what I saw there is that the two methyl groups of the two different compounds are pointing into different directions. So of one end state, it's pointing to right, of the other, it's pointing to the left. And this is, of course, a problem. That means the mapping cannot be done very efficiently, and the simulations cannot converge. I've now run the new simulations with different starting structures. But there we have also another issue here. We can have a different tautomer of the heterocycle with two nitrogens. I just see that this should be an N, not an NH here. And we have to be careful when picking input structures that we have do not only have different tautomers here, but we can also have a different tautomer. And probably it's also better to have a different tautomer, the other tautomer in the case of the green starting structure. Other outliers are these edges, one from the MCL, one data set where we again have we could have problems with a rotamer here. So it's not clear which of these two methyl groups should be deleted during the run. And also this oxygen to NH perturbation, which could be difficult if it's inside a narrow pocket, binding pocket, for example. And the same here in chunk one, there are two bromine atoms created, which are quite bulky and could be, and this could be again problematic in narrow pockets. Now we want also to have a look at the agreement with the previously done calculations, which are and here compare the results with GAF 2.1 calculations. And in general, we have much better agreement with the other calculated data than with the experiment. I mean, nice correlations and the distribution here, a deviation distribution with a standard deviation of 1.1 kcal per mole. If we now compare the different sets of calculated results, once with OPLS3E, done with FEP+, GAF 2.1 and Parsley both run with the PMX non-equilibrium method, we see that the outliers are quite specific to different force fields. So there's only 1/3 of all outliers with a deviation of more than 2 kcal per mole from experiment are shared with the different force fields. So it's quite specific. On the other hand, if you look at the successes with a deviation of less than 1 kcal per mole, there are a lot of simulations or perturbations shared with the different between the different calculation set. And about these 24 perturbations down here, we can be very happy because these are only have the lowest deviation with the Parsley parameters. And we should, of course, in future work, worry about these 30 perturbations and try to see whether there's something wrong with the parameters or whether we can improve the parameters in the future. So to summarize, based on the specific requirements, the first version of the benchmark data set was created. The first results are encouraging. And some outliers can be identified as being either not converged or as being wrongly prepared or unsuitably prepared. The ongoing work is to further disentangle method differences from the or preparation differences from the force field, and in long-term future, we want to continuously add new targets to the data set, run more and more calculations, also with new versions of the open force fields, and then also improve the input structure based on best practices. With this, I want to thank all the collaborators. So from the open, of course, the whole open force field community, especially my supervisors, David and John, and our software scientist, Jeff and Hannah from the Codera lab. Then my supervisor at Janssen, Gary, and my colleague, Laura, and our team leader, Hermann, as well as the whole group at Janssen. Finally, I had great discussions with Chris and Gaetano from OpenAI, and I'm working on the workflow together with Bert, Vitas, and Euro. With this, I want to thank for your attention, and I'm open to any question. Thanks.
David, I thought that was a really wonderful talk. I have one burning question, which is that in the distribution of the delta-delta Gs, they all seem to be skewed positive. Do you have any idea why that is?
I haven't seen this skew. Let me go back. You mean here?
Yeah, so if I look at the fitted symmetric curve, it looks like there's more unoccupied space under it on the left than on the right.
I have no explanation about this. I haven't thought about this.
It's interesting. It almost makes me think that maybe it's a sampling problem, that these transitions from a low energy state to a high energy state, maybe they haven't converged. Though I don't know, we can talk about this offline. I just thought that was a really interesting trend.
Yeah, thanks for this observation. I'll also look into this. Any more questions?
Are there places where you would especially appreciate help from the community?
So I would say in developing the benchmark data set, or especially the programmable interface there, I can need some help to get this forward. Otherwise, there's also a lot of methodological issues or challenges, which we can, for example, yeah, enhancing the sampling along the for the perturbations or in the equilibrium runs to generate a representative ensemble of starting structures for the non-equilibrium runs. There are a lot of interesting science questions which I'm happy to work with other people on.
Thanks.